going to be like a lot of the same questions that we already talked about over the phone.
Okay.
So just can you, I guess, talk about your daughter, what she was like, and then kind of talk about, you know, then her story again, the what she went through leading up to when she took her life.
Okay. Alicia was a normal, typical young girl. She loved school. She loved to play outside. She had a great imagination. And life was normal, you know. We had another daughter, you know, and two-parent family. And like I said, it was just normal. And then one day she got sick. And after being hospitalized and a lot of tests, we found out that she had juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. And Alicia could never really comprehend that. That was an old person's disease, not somebody who is in the fifth grade would have it. And she had a very different rare form. It was called systemic JRA, which was the inflammation was around her organs and not her joints. And so she took a lot of steroids continuously from fifth grade all the way till the time that she passed. And so her body changed a lot, being on steroids and not being able to do what other kids could do. She was a good kid, she was a sweet kid. She loved to help others. And then she was probably in 10th grade. And she went out, she didn't want to go to school that day. And I told her she had to. And she went out to the bus stop with her sister. And she took a whole handful of Advil and popped it in her mouth. And then her sister came running in to tell me. And she spit them out of her mouth, but then she still wanted to go to school. And I told her she couldn't, and I called her doctor, and they called me, and they got in touch with her doctors up at Yale, and they wanted to see her. And she was put on psychiatric watch for 24 hours, but they felt it was more of an attention getter thing. But I still was, we still were concerned because up until that point, we never heard the word suicide. I never knew anybody who took their own life. It was just something that nobody ever talked about. And life got a little difficult after that with her. She, a lot of things changed. She almost became like an Alicia we didn't know. She started failing school on purpose. Nothing we did was right. We tried to get help for her, but she didn't want it. We did make her go to therapy though. And the therapist said, you know, even though she's not paying attention, and it looks like she's not paying attention, I know she is, so we did continue the therapy. And then it was the summer of July 4th of 2000, and we'd spent the whole day with her at my sister-in-law's, and we had a picnic, and she was fine, you know, and she came home, and at the time she was living with a friend, a girl from school, and she said she got kicked out. They didn't want her to live there anymore. And so she asked if she could come back home and live. And we said, well, the rules are gonna be the same. You know, there's, you couldn't abide by them before, you know, so what's going to change? Because we're not going to deal with those things. It's not fair to your sister. She said, you know, this is not, I don't want to stay, you know. And so she left. And about an hour later, we we got a phone call from her therapist, and she said, "Have you talked to Alicia?" I said, "Yeah, we spent the whole day with her, you know, and she just left like an hour ago." And she said, "Well, she called me, and we didn't have a good connection, so I told her to call me back, and she hasn't." She said, "I want you to go look for her." So we were getting ready to go look for her, and she called us, and she said that she wanted to go to heaven. So we called the police, and every time she called us, they tracked the number down and go look for her, but she would be gone. I said, then she called back and said she didn't take it, any of the drugs, and but they still were gonna look for her, and they found her in Stratford. They said she didn't look very good, but she still was alive. And they took her to Bridgeport Hospital, and we got there. And we talked to her for a couple minutes. And then a nurse saw something. To this day, I still don't know what it was, but they all came rushing in and took her away. And she passed away that night. And it changes your life forever. You know, everything is, did it happen before Alicia died or after Alicia died? That's how my life is divided right now.
Right.
And my sister-in-law was kind enough to find us a couple support groups. We went to one, if you just lost a child, and we weren't really comfortable at that one. Because it was all different reasons why they had lost, you had lost a child. And then we went to another support group that I've been going to now for 17 years. And it's just for suicide, even though it's different. It could be your spouse you lost, or a brother, or, you know, a child. But there's all that common factor of suicide, and it's how different it is from other deaths.
How is it different? Support group that specifically dealt with people who lost someone to suicide?
A lot of people look at you very differently when you say suicide or took their life. They just stop talking to you. We lost a lot of friends and family members. People just don't understand what we go through and how different it is. I mean, I've lost a parent. I just lost a niece. And it's a different type of loss. And nobody gets it unless you've been through it. I mean, I went for therapy, and she had never known anybody. She had not lost anybody to suicide. So it was just very different, you know. And like I said, people don't understand it because it's not talked about. There's that stigma still towards it. And depression, I mean, most of the people who take their lives are depressed. Bipolar, there's many types of depression, and people don't understand that that's an illness, just like cancer is. Depression's an illness. There's that stigma towards it that, you know, my daughter thought, that's for crazy people. I'm not crazy. And I said, well, we didn't say you were crazy, but you need some help. And she didn't, you know, want it. And you have to want it for it to help. Life was tough after that. Then you have to learn how to survive without your child. It takes a lot of hard work. Luckily, we were in therapy before it happened, so we had that in place, and that helped a lot. Our minister helped a lot. Like I said, not a lot of family helped a lot, but your true friends are there for you and let you talk about it many, many times, and they don't say to you, get over it, it's 3 months, you should be done with it, you know, move on. It doesn't happen that way. I mean, even 17 years down the road, I still have my moments where it's hard. It's very hard. And, you know, you wonder what she would be doing now. She would be married, if she would have grandchildren, you know, if we would have grandchildren. But I guess my hope is that people learn to talk about it. We are very open with it. If somebody, I mean, it's not the first thing we say to a stranger, but if we get talking and they say, how many children do you have? I'm very honest, I have 2 children still. And I always start with Allison, and I say, you know, what she's doing, and then I say our other daughter took her life 17 years ago. And a lot of times it brings up us, people are like, oh, well, gee, I lost somebody, but I've never told anybody. And it's amazing how many people have never spoken of it or talked to anybody about it. And they've bottled that up inside of them, and I don't know how that they do it. I mean, it's not for me. I need to talk about it. I still want pictures around of her. I still want to bring up the memories of her, you know, and we had a lot of good memories, and I'm not going to forget those. And I wish that they would do more in the schools and talk about it. I wish it wasn't on the websites, you know, that you can go on and see how to take your life. I don't think those should be on there. But people need to be honest about it. It's nothing to be ashamed of. I'm not ashamed. I'm not angry with my daughter. But I do wish that there was more in the school systems and colleges about suicide. And it can affect anybody, and you know, don't think that it can't happen to your family, because it can. And it did.
Is there anything new that you've learned since having this experience about suicide that you didn't know before?
Well, I have to say, I basically knew nothing about suicide, because I've never met, none of my friends ever took their life, no family member had ever taken their life. I've learned that most people have depression. Some of them use drug and alcohols to hide it. My daughter did not do that. She did take a very lethal drug from her arthritis that she took. I've learned it happens to very nice people. It can happen at any age. Multiple suicides have happened in families. Definitely pay attention to what your loved ones are saying, because I think after the fact, sometimes you think, oh, well, she said this, or she did this, but I didn't pick up on it. But I think if you had known about suicide and knew what to look for, I'm not saying you could prevent it, but I think you'd have a better handle on it.
There are clues with Alicia, looking back, that you recognize now?
The only thing that we can I think hers was more of an impulse type suicide. I'm not sure she thought it through 100%. And that happens, I think, in teens. You know, oh, my boyfriend broke up with me, it's the end of my life, you know, and things like that. I think hers might have been, but then again, I don't know, because not until I see her again someday will I know. She told her father that she wanted to be an organ donor a few days before she had just gotten her license. I mean, she was doing, she got her license, she made a dentist appointment, you know, a day or two before she took her life. And we have found that a lot of people do things like that. I'm not sure why they do it, but you know, they do it. And
I guess now, what would you want other people to know, other parents with kids who are struggling? Maybe they have suicidal thoughts, but the parents don't know, or did try to take their life at least once?
Get them help. Take them for counseling. Let your doctors know. And do everything in your power for them. But sometimes you could do everything and anything for them, and somehow they still seem to slip through the cracks. So getting them help, talking to them, keeping communication with their friends, because sometimes they tell their friends things that they won't tell us as parents, and let their friends know that it's okay to say it, and don't think that they're going to be mad at you or anything like that, because it's their life you're talking about. And if they get mad at you, oh well, it happens. But if you could save their life, that there is hope at the end of the tunnel. There's that light. And a lot of times they just can't see that light at the end of the tunnel. And they're struggling with pain. And to them, this is the only way out. I mean, we would have done anything she asked us to do. But we also have people that are older who refuse treatment. So it's not just teenagers. It's anybody that can refuse treatment. You know, they think there's nothing wrong with them, leave me alone. But there is help out there. The American Foundation Suicide for Prevention. You could contact them. You can call 211 and get help. So there's a lot of different things you can do, you know, to help them. But I think talking to them is probably one of the best things you can do, is keep that line of communication open.